through shame and break through that kind of denial. Because, as I said earlier, the first target of this disease is awareness. Alan, you like the way the slide looks?
Yeah.
Alan and I were talking about death by PowerPoint. Too much words on one slide and you fall asleep. It's like, right? Soma. Okay. I'm trying to meet you all where you're at 8 o'clock instead of 1. Okay. So what's the order of the demise? Usually the home is completely wrecked. People are sleeping in different bedrooms. People are sleeping in different bedrooms. The nanny is listening to fights upstairs. The disease is running rampant, but it's a secret. And that secret can only contain itself in the vessel of community for so long, and then it's going to leak out, and there's going to be a whisper and a party. Boy, did you see them get loaded that night, or there's a DUI, or something hush, and now it's going around, and bills aren't being paid, and people are starting to ask questions, and is she okay? And you start to see symptoms in the kids and people talking. Now you get to the system that has always protected. If the system starts to crack and people worry in the system, this is wonderful. This is where you have the opportunity to self-report, to ask for help, whether it's a physician or a banker. This is the time that is most valuable, but unfortunately, far too many people wait till it gets into the workplace with the embarrassing adverse event or the legal action that takes them out. Again, one of the reasons these people are so hard to treat is that they're so far delayed in treatment. The disease has got its claws in and it's been festering for years and years, like any disease that's left untreated. You have to break through the malignant denial, give them treatment that's long enough. Make sure that there are extraordinary boundaries in place, because these people wouldn't know a boundary if it bit them on the butt. Literally. You have to develop a system of monitoring and find out who the advocates are going to be for this patient. They need to have advocacy. The standard of care for the appropriate treatment of substance abusing professional is to look at the kind of trickle-down responsibility they have. Are you going to be able to find the Achilles heel? It's easy with the doc, it's his medical license. It's easy with the pilot, it's the FAA. Not so hard with the attorney because it's the Bar Association. But what about a guy that owns his own company or an entertainer who's worshipped? What's the Achilles heel? Usually, it's their mind. If you can convince them that mindlessness and powerlessness are inevitable, whether they agree to the powerlessness first or they go to the point of mindlessness and lose their power, is up to them. So you have to find the point of power. What's their Achilles heel? And a good narcissist, they don't want to hear that they're losing their cognitive edge. So a clinical diagnostic evaluation, full history, physical, blood work, major psychiatric evaluation, biopsychosocial, full psychological evaluation, and all of the psychometric testing at a time that's appropriate depending on their detox needs is critical to get to the baseline of where they're at. And then you can tell them, man, I'm surprised you can read a street sign. Your spatial recognition is gone. You've lost about 12 IQ points from that last time you tested. You have no memory left. Benzodiazepines have eaten you up. The other executive crisis is benzodiazepines, which for you to think about is really alcohol and dehydrated alcohol. From the brain's point of view, two or three Xanax is like a quart of vodka. And people will probably say, well, I only do 10 Xanax a day. You know, when you tell them that converts over to about three quarts of vodka, they kind of start to listen. The liver may be spared, but not the mind, not the brain. So we get that data and then show them that with sustained abstinence and, you know, it's evidence-based nutritional therapy for neurocognitive restoration is the way to go right now. We vigorously pursue that in all our patients to try to get that, you know, what's left, because there is a point of no return. And I educate everyone about Wernicke's encephalopathy. There's nothing sad. My last big patient, a man with a net worth of billions of dollars, esteemed in his field, had 7 head injuries from alcohol-related falls in front of his board of directors, in front of his top achievers in the company, in tuxedos at great functions, and still denied he had a problem after the head injuries. I got him into treatment, and he had a stroke. We put him in stroke rehab, and as soon as he woke up from his stroke and they started to question about his drinking habits, he said, I have a couple. And they said, well, you know what? If you keep that up, we'll be fine with just a couple. You can say a couple of quarts. He had a stroke. There is a time when you just know you're losing. And all you can do when the wife called me that 100th time is I said, let's sit down and think about where he wants to be buried. And what we're going to do for you. Sometimes the only success in these cases is to make sure you take an adequate care of the poor person who's in the side with the collateral damage, you know. We then give them as much residential treatment as we can and then monitor them vigorously in aftercare. When I see a professional that comes in from the East Coast, I will get a medical